Welcome to Brandventures, and get ready for an exciting adventure into the world of brand innovation on the Brandventures Podcast. GP5, production for adventurous brands. Hey guys, welcome to the Brand Ventures, the show that's gonna take you into the world of adventurous brands. I'm your host, Gustavo, and today we're in the heart of Venice Beach for a very special episode. And our guest today is none other than Greg Falk. Greg is a visionary and one of the great minds behind this brand, Carver, a skateboard company born in these very streets. He's not just an entrepreneur, he's an artist with a knack for design and engineering. Together with his partner, Neil, they did not only build an empire of skateboarding, they actually pioneered a new sport called surf skate. Stick around until we explore his incredible journey and the impact he's had on the skating world. Welcome to the Brand Ventures, Greg.
Good morning.
Tell me a little bit more about you. You're born and raised here in Venice?
Well, I was born in Inglewood, down the street, and grew up surfing the bay here, you know, from El Porto to Malibu. Initially, you know, it was the bathtub where I got my most inspiration. I remember being an infant, just being in the bathtub and just being submerged and thinking, God, this is so inspiring, you know? Something about the us being electrical and being submerged in this, you know, the water.
Yeah. Right?
And then when I was introduced to the ocean, whole other level, right? All the movement and all of the trace minerals and salts out there beyond words, right? I mean, the experience of being in there. Now, because we evolved from the ocean, you know, our tears and our sperm and our sweat, you know, it's all salt, you know? And so I think that we return to the ocean when we go out there.
Tell me a little bit about your art. What is it that we can see in your place here? There's a mix of things and materials, and what's your art about?
My studio is sort of a sanctuary for creation. I'm intrigued by how form manifests, the forces that play, that, you know, decide the shape of our organs, decide the shape of a seed pod or a seashell. And so I gather these objects and I use them to inform my understanding of form and how it manifests and maybe where I am on that continuum of natural law.
How do you think being an artist has influenced the design of Carver?
You know, as an artist, I make things to evoke emotion, to elevate the quality of my life and those around me. Carver, when we first created it, we were trying to create sort of a trailing wheel. And I had just finished a show at the Turner Gallery down the street where I used this special thrust bearing. It's like this industrial set of barrel beads that rotated very, very small and compact and industrial quality. So you can ollie and land on it. And I don't think we anticipated that we would still be using those thrust bearings today, but our C7 uses two sets of those.
What excites Greg the most?
Let's see. You know, I wake up every day and I have ideas and I come into this studio and I make them, I express them. And that's what excites me. You know, looking at the world around me and finding opportunities to add value, to improve things and to be fertile, you know, and active in my environment.
So what is a Carver board?
Let's see. A Carver is a skateboard that is a system. The deck is specific. It has concave and usually a tail and nose kick. It has specific wheels that, you know, grip well. And it has two different trucks. The truck in the front performs like the rails on a surfboard. We call it twist and sway. And so it has that sway function like a surfboard does. And the back truck performs like your fins. It gives the board directionality and stability. So the sum of those components is a Carver.
What's the difference between the trucks?
Well, let's see. Our C7, this is the first truck that we came out with. This was sort of a prototype. This was designed to be able to adjust the twist and the sway functions
Okay.
And determine the perfect ratio, right?
Yeah.
But it turned out to be a great tool. And it has a dual axis truck. It's the only dual axis truck with independent control of both the twist and the sway. Wow. There are other trucks out there now that have dual axis, but you can't control them both. And then this is a CX, which basically has the same net geometry. If you were to take a pencil and trace this, it has the same geometry as this without all of the hardware. So it's much lighter.
Oh, wow.
You know, now they all come with hollow axles and hollow kingpins, so they're all very light. But the CX is only a two-part single axis. This is a dual axis truck.
Oh, wow.
But we were interested in being able to negotiate the hill and be able to control and amortize our speed, right? And get data with control, not with just gravity. Because a surfboard comes to a point, when you engage the rail, it thrusts forward. Right. So that's why we do that. Right.
Yeah.
So our skateboard, just like the surfboard, when you engage the rail, thrusts forward. So you don't need to push it. And even, you know, uphill, it propels. You know, imagine if a car didn't have the steering wheel and the ability to turn the front wheels for directionality, or a bicycle. Right. Or marine life. You look at a fish, you see that it's the head leads. Yeah. Right?
Absolutely.
And so it needs very specific geometry to do that.
Okay.
And that's what the Carver does, the C7 or the CX. That's what they do.
Tell me about the first iterations of the truck.
Well, you know, initially we didn't know that it was going to be about the truck. We thought it might have been the deck. So literally cut the deck in two and we put the thrust bearings in the middle.
Yeah.
And it was that sort of projected light, you know, towards the notion of creating a trailing wheel.
Mm-hmm.
And and then eventually it became very clear that the deck did have certain qualities that it needed in order to perform well, but it was really about the trucks.
How was those first days of building Carver?
I was living in a church on Venice Boulevard, and it was my studio. And then one day, Oliver Stone knocked on the door, and I knew the writing was on the wall. I wouldn't be there for long. Yeah, Venice was, you know, popping at the time. And so having sold my car, I had to move my studio to my house on my skateboard. And on the way, I rode by this guy's studio, and I looked in there, and, you know, his studio looked like my studio. Everything was sort of modified. You know, nothing was as it should be. It was modified, you know, and we began hanging out and talking and surfing together, and the breakwater was flat one summer, completely a lake. And we took our skateboards that we had to, you know, the hills of Santa Monica.
Yeah.
And we attempted to go surf skating. And we said, this doesn't feel like our surfboard.
Yeah.
So we returned to Marine Street, the steepest hill in Santa Monica, every day for about 3 years. And continuously improved and tweaked the trucks and until they performed well. And then we were addicted, right? And then Carver was sort of an extension of our desire to share this with others. Less entrepreneurial pursuit and more about the way it felt to ride a Carver. It makes me smile even just thinking about it. And I don't know, when I drop into a wave, I have this sort of involuntary little hoot. Like I literally, it's involuntary, you know? And I get that on Carver, right? And so we wanted to share that, you know, you want to share that with your bros and your community. And so that was the motivation really. And we wanted it to be like a skater made company. We didn't want to approach it like businessmen. We wanted to be spoily skaters, you know, that took over a factory and making skateboards instead of other automobiles or something.
Okay. There's a group of girls that adopted your product and they, you know, they've created a whole movement around it. Can you tell me a little bit more about them?
Girl Swirl, they're amazing. I think the impetus was Lucy and Lindsay and just a few local girls that just love riding their boards. And, you know, I guess when you're a girl riding a skateboard, you get a lot of the wrong attention. But when you get you know, 10 girls skating together, it's critical mass and it's powerful, and guys fall silent all of a sudden, you know, it's letting them work. And so they're really embracing that. And so they get together, you know, in mass, sometimes there's 50 or 100 of them, and they just hang and skate, and, you know, and it's really, really profound, really the influence they've had on bringing new people, new females, you know, young and old, to the skate table.
This design had really sparked a new kind of approach to skating, which is the surf skate, right?
That's right.
What are the differences between skating and surf skating?
Well, you know, skateboarding is broad, right? There's half pipe, there's bowl riding, there's street cats, right? Everyone has their different expression. So Carver is among them, right? And Carver sort of accentuates the surf aspect of a skateboard. And I think that Girl Swirl is attracted to the ability to express yourself on a skateboard. There's actually a neurological basis for that. In our inner ear, we have these stones called otoliths. They're made of calcium carbonate, like seashells.
Oh, wow.
And they move within a membrane in our inner ear. I always picture an anemone.
Yeah,
and these stones moving in it. And the stones are tethered to the magma core of the earth. And when we accelerate angularly or laterally, these stones move in the membrane. And so I call it jiggling the stones. And so our sort of goal indirectly was to have the stones jiggle in the same way that they do on a surfboard as they do on a skateboard. You know, some people are ballerinas, some people are soccer players. We all jiggle our stones in different ways. But the rhythm of the movement of the stones is, I think, what's interesting. And I think the girls are attracted to the way it jiggles their stones.
I also think that the Carver has allowed for femininity to be brought into skating. Not just femininity, but agility and like a whole rhythm, another dance.
I was reading this article by Red Bull. And in it, the guy who they interviewed said that surf skate is the child of both surfing and skateboarding. The father is skateboarding and the mother is surfing. And we know mother's always right.
They are always right. Who would you say are a list of your three most notable riders?
Our first team rider was a guy named Laird Hamilton.
Okay.
And then he's, you know, a legend and an amazing innovator. But and now recently we signed Kai Lenny.
Oh, no way.
Who's other level.
Yeah.
You know.
He's an alien.
Yeah, he is an alien. And I really appreciate his everything, his innovation and his integrity. And let's see, we've been working with Taylor Knox for 10 years maybe.
Okay.
And he's part of our family.
Is that him on that magazine?
Yeah. Yep.
How do you guys come up with that idea?
Carver is about movement, right? That's what distinguishes it. And so to have a, you know, back in those days, we were advertising in, you know, Juice magazine and Surfer magazine. And so we had these sequence shots that we would do. Mm. And when we did the shot with Taylor Knox, he wanted his photographer to do the shoot. And it was a guy named Art Brewer.
Okay.
Legendary.
Okay, Art Brewer, what a name.
Exactly, Art Brewer, right? It's like, great pun. But he's ridiculously talented guy, and I guess he had been working with Taylor for years and was sort of a father figure.
Okay.
So he ended up driving Taylor hard that day,
yeah.
over again. And he taught us how to properly do these sequence shots with this plate system.
Mm-hmm.
And from that point on, it, you know, changed how we did things. He really influenced us. In fact, that day we produced maybe 4 ads from the photographs we took on that day.
Okay.
That's how, you know, powerful he was. And, you know, Taylor was exhausted and Art said, no, we're going to another, we're driving over here. And it was really, really cool to learn from Art.
We worked on a project for Not Impossible Labs and Mick Ebeling where you had to design. Electric wheelchair.
Yes.
Can you tell me a little bit of what happened?
That was a really fun project that I'm still involved with. But really the goal was to create a modular electric wheelchair, right? We have these scooters on every corner nowadays, but the wheelchair industry is pretty antiquated. It hasn't kept up.
That's true.
So the goal was to fast forward it, right? To bring it to state of the art. And so we made several prototypes that are electric wheelchairs that break down into small parts. And our case study was this young lady named Kelly Lee. Mm-hmm. And so we built it for Kelly. And I remember the last prototype that we created, she actually drove it in. There was a big convention to celebrate, and she actually drove it in to the convention.
No way.
And only 10 minutes prior to that, she had toppled the thing and turned it by over-accelerating outside. She actually fell pretty bad, but she was such a good sport. But yes, electric wheelchair, one of my favorite projects.
Yeah. Talk about, exciting those... the particles in your ear, right?
That's right. The stones, yearling the stones.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What do you think has been the biggest challenge for Carver?
So initially, I think the steepest hill was convincing people just to try it.
Yeah.
Once they did, especially the surfers among them got it and realized, hey, this is a surf tool. But yeah, that was the steepest hill. Early adoption was resistant.
Was there any point where you're like, this is not going to work? You're like,
just
I've
yesterday. No, I'm kidding. No, it's like a child. It has to survive. I know the way you guys feel about Carver.
Yeah.
Well, I feel the same way, and my business partner as well. So Carver will always exist. And it really is not a, capitalistic pursuit, right? It's only a byproduct of our commitment to delivering to our customers. With all of the transparency today of social media, all you have to do is be honest and produce the best product that you can and open your kimono and your customers know who you are. So all we've done is we've been sincere in delivering on the promise of Surfscape. And we effort to make it as inexpensive as we can. Our motivation isn't profit. Now, we have adults in the room like Dave who make sure that it's as well profit. But our motivation is delivering the experience of Surfscape to our customers and having it endure. We think it's important that it lasts, a lifetime.
What was that spark that really, or the impetus that turned play and game into a serious business?
It wasn't a vision. It creaked. It ebbed and flowed. And initially, no one wanted our truck. It was this trailing wheel system. It looked very different, felt very different, didn't feel like a skateboard at all. So initially, we had trouble convincing others to get out. Once they did get on it, I fell in love with it. But there was this moment where Japan, we went to this convention and what is currently our Japanese distributor approached us. And I think they ordered 600 Carvers.
No way.
And so we went right to work making 600 Carvers. Wow. And we couldn't make enough. Like, it was hard to keep up at the time because we were just, just three of us at the time. And it was a series of those fits and starts, and Carver just responded. We continuously grow and evolve, and currently we have a proper formal president. I call him the adult in the room,
the boss.
yeah, and his name is Dave.
Okay,
Dave Root, and he's super talented. And but it's only through 27 years of trials and tribulations that we've wound up here, and have a highly effective, functional company. Every year, we call it Kaizen, and it's constant improvement. We listen to our customers, and we guarantee these trucks for life. So if anything breaks, our customers let us know, and we see what is weak in the system, and we upgrade it. So we're always improving it, constantly, even 27 years later. We're hoping that the children that we pass it on so other generations can have a surf skate too.
So what does the next 10 years look like for Carver?
Well, we're going to continue to innovate, and right now we're about to come out with this new plastic skateboard made out of recycled fishing nets. Fishing nets are made of nylon 6, very structural plastic. So rather than the nets being dumped in the ocean and killing fish and other mammals, we recycle them in a skateboard. This one was about performance. This one here is basically, we use plastic because it could be plastic. It was the best medium, the best material. Wood has limitations. We call it produce.
Yeah.
You know, it changes and warps. And there's also limitations to what you can do with compound curves on a deck. But plastic is completely malleable. So we're able to, you know, achieve all of the wheel wells and compound curves that we need to. So this deck is committed to performance. Really what it's about.
Oh, wow.
Even though you're healing the planet when you buy it and ride it, it's also about performance and longevity.
Oh, it's a win-win.
Yeah.
And this hasn't come out yet, right?
I'd say about 2 more months it'll be available.
Well, now you know. You guys have the scoop.
Get ready.
Does it come with a specific design with the wheels and the what truck does it use?
It's going to be all black. It's going to be a black deck. This plastic will be black instead of this gray. The trucks will be blacked out and the wheels will be black.
That's my style.
Yeah.
So, Greg, thanks so much for having us over at your amazing place. It's really inspiring to be next to someone that's done such amazing things for skating. And at a human level, I really appreciate you opening up your doors and having us over here. This is going to be a wrap for 2023 for us. It's our first season, and we're super excited to end it in such a great way. Thanks so much, Greg.
Thank you.
GP5, production for adventurous brands.